Positioning of the patient is essential to accurately measure blood pressure. The patient's back and legs should be supported, with legs uncrossed and feet resting on a firm surface. The patient's arm should be bare to the shoulder. The arm should be supported at heart level. The manometer should be at the eye level of the healthcare practitioner. A common error in taking blood pressure is the use of an improperly fitted cuff. Selection of an appropriately sized cuff requires assessment of the arm circumference. The midpoint position is determined by measuring the distance between the olecranon and acromion processes. The arm circumference is then measured at the midpoint. Once the arm circumference has been determined, the appropriate size cuff can be selected. Cuffs typically are marked with acceptable sizing indicators to facilitate proper fitting. However, it is more important to use a cuff that is appropriately sized for the arm. To assist in selecting the appropriate size, cuffs should be marked with an index line that runs perpendicular to the length of the cuff and a range line that runs parallel to the length of the cuff. The index line should fall within the range line when the cuff is secured to the upper arm. The cuff should be applied 2 centimeters above the crease of the elbow. It should fit snugly, but still allow 2 finger widths under the cuff. Next, find the brachial artery, which is palpable approximately 4 to 5 centimeters from the medial epicondyle on the anterior surface of the elbow. Place the stethoscope lightly against the skin over the brachial artery. There should be appropriate pressure to ensure good sound transmission. The stethoscope should not be in contact with clothing or with the cuff. Inflating the cuff to some arbitrary level runs the risk of excessive overinflation. To avoid this, determine the measurement of the pulse obliteration pressure. Rapidly inflate the cuff to 80 millimeters of mercury while palpating the radial artery pulse. Continue to inflate in 10 millimeter of mercury increments, taking note of the reading at which the pulse disappears. Then, deflate the cuff at a rate of 2 millimeters of mercury per second, noting when the pulse reappears. Once the pulse obliteration pressure is determined, you are ready to measure the blood pressure. Inflate the cuff to a level 20 to 30 millimeters of mercury above the pulse obliteration pressure. Then, deflate the cuff at a rate of approximately 2 millimeters of mercury per second while listening for sounds. As the pressure in the cuff is decreased, blood flow in the brachial artery increases, creating turbulence, which generates Karat cough sounds. Phase 1 sounds are clear, repetitive tapping sounds that coincide with reappearance of a palpable radial or brachial pulse. The onset of Phase 1 sounds are equivalent to the systolic blood pressure. Phase 2 sounds are audible murmurs in the tapping sounds. Phase 3 and 4 sounds are muted changes in the tapping sounds that occur as the pressure measurement approaches the diastolic pressure, usually within 10 millimeters of mercury of true diastolic pressure. Phase 5 sound is not really a sound, but rather is the level at which sounds disappear. Phase 5 indicates the diastolic blood pressure. To ensure that diastole has been reached, the cuff pressure should continue to be deflated for an additional 10 millimeters of mercury beyond the fifth carotid cough sound. You should measure the blood pressure twice at a minimum, waiting at least 1 minute between readings. The average of the measurements should be recorded. In the following example, the patient's blood pressure is 116 over 90 millimeters of mercury. You will hear nothing until the first carotid cough sound appears at 116 millimeters of mercury. The various phases of carotid cough sounds will be heard until their disappearance at 90 millimeters of mercury.